Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Emotionally Absent Mother, How to Recognize and Heal the Invisible Effects of Childhood Emotional Neglect, Second Edition, by Jasmin Lee Cori, MS, LPC, narrated by Emily Durante. Mommy, where were you? My first steps. I stood there, teetering, so proud, ecstatic as a baby bird learning it could fly. When I looked back, my smile about to break my face, I couldn't find you. Mommy, where were you? My first day of school, boarded onto that noisy, clackety bus, going to a strange place, kids crowding, adults peering, the whole world new to me. Mommy, where were you? The first time I came home crying, the butt of children's laughter, their words still stinging in my head, I would have liked some consolation, but you were silent. You are there in old photographs, but in my memories, you are missing. I don't remember cuddling or being comforted, no special moments, just the two of us. I don't remember your smell or the feel of your touch. I remember the color of your eyes and the pain deep inside them, the pain usually hidden, like so much else, beneath the mask I couldn't get behind. You looked, but didn't see me. Your warmth never reached my little girl's heart. Why did we miss each other, Mommy? Where were you? Was it because of me? J.C. Introduction to the Second Edition. Few experiences in life are as deep as the feelings we carry about our mothers. The roots of some of these feelings are lost in the dark recesses of pre-verbal experience. The branches go every which way, some holding glorious, sun-drenched moments, while others are broken off, leaving sharp and jagged edges that we get caught on. Mother is not a simple subject. On both a cultural and a psychological level, our feelings about mothers are often inconsistent and tangled. Mom and apple pie are potent symbols, venerated in our national psyche, but neglected in national policy, as reflected, for example, in our meager family leave policies in comparison with other developed countries. If we were really serious about mothering, we would provide more financial and in-home help, as well as education, for mothers. As it currently stands, mothers are held up on a pedestal with little support beneath them. We are aware of this as adults. Few of us escape the feeling that mothers are to be honored, or the awareness that mothers are too often taken for granted and their sacrifices unappreciated. Yet many of us are secretly, or not so secretly, unsatisfied with what we got from our mothers, and resentful that, whether their fault or not, they failed to provide important aspects of what we needed, and we're paying the price. These are sensitive issues, sensitive for mothers and sensitive for all of us. Some, in a need to make mothers off limits from criticism, become critical of those who are unsatisfied, blaming us for blaming our mothers, as if we are unfairly passing off the responsibility for our suffering. While I don't deny that some may use blame as a distraction and fail to take responsibility for the arduous task of healing, what I see more often as a therapist is the enormous guilt and resistance people have to work through in order to stop protecting their mothers. It is as if, even within the privacy of our own minds, we are afraid to criticize her. We are protecting the image of mother inside, protecting our fragile relationship with her by denying anything that might unsettle it, and protecting ourselves from the disappointment, anger, and pain that we've kept out of consciousness. As I will explain in the chapters that follow, many don't dare to uncover the painful truth of what was missing in their mothers because they are unprepared to deal with what this would mean. Any relationship as complex as that between mother and child is going to include both love and hate. Most young children feel moments of hatred when their needs or wishes are frustrated. Although many children wouldn't dare express this, their bond with mommy far too fragile. And virtually all children feel love for mother, even when that love is buried or walled off. As Robert Caron eloquently reported in his compilation of research on attachment, virtually all children, even abused children, love their parents. It's built into the nature of being a child. They may be hurt, disappointed, caught in destructive modes of being that ward off any possibility of getting the love they yearn for, but to be attached, even anxiously attached, is to be in love. Each year, the love may become a little more difficult to access. Each year, the child may disavow his wish for connection more firmly. He may even swear off his parents and deny that he has any love for them at all. But the love is there, as is the longing to actively express it and to have it returned, hidden like a burning sun. Caron's words show some of the complexity of this relationship. No one escapes wanting a mother's love. Mothering is also a sensitive topic for those who are mothers. When I was first working on this book, I noticed some guilt and defensiveness when I would share what I was writing about with women who were mothers. They wanted to say, "Don't give me so much power. There are many other influences in a child's life. It's not all my fault how they turned out." All very true. We come in with individual differences that are stunning. And there are other childhood influences as well, including birth order, bonding with father and his adequacy as a parent, environmental and genetic influences on a child's basic physiology, family dynamics, and important events in the family, such as a major illness, and the stresses in the larger culture. Despite these many factors, the impact of mother is unparalleled. An attentive, capable, caring mother can help make up for many other handicaps, and the absence of such mothering is perhaps the greatest handicap of all, because when mother is not doing her larger-than-life job as it needs to be done, children have significant deficits in their foundations. My focus on the mother is not because mothers need more guilt or responsibility heaped on, but because the quality of the mothering we receive so powerfully shapes our development. My hope is that understanding these influences will lead us to better understand ourselves and, most important, to complete the developmental tasks and heal the injuries that resulted from insufficient mothering. For those listeners who are mothers or who are becoming mothers, it is my hope that my breaking down the roles of mothering as I do here and highlighting the central importance of nurturing will help train your focus. Although there are aspects of mothering that are instinctive and are passed through the generations by women who were well-mothered themselves, for many women, mothering must be consciously learned. If you were inadequately mothered, your task will be twofold: to heal your own wounds and to open up a different way of being with your children than your mother was with you. As I began working, I wanted to supplement my understanding of the undermothered adults I had experienced within my own circle and in my psychotherapy practice, so I put out a call for undermothered adults to interview. I was immediately flooded with responses. As might be expected, I found more women than men who were willing to talk with a stranger about their experiences, although I also had more access to women. There was nothing scientific about my sampling, so I can't claim to have captured the undermothered from a demographic or sociological perspective, but I think their brave and often insightful disclosures have some value for us all. Some of my findings are sprinkled throughout the chapters, but most of them are found in Chapter 6, Living with an Emotionally Absent Mother, where I describe both the childhood environments my interviewees experienced and the challenges they have faced as adults. In the first edition of this book, my focus was on the effects of having been raised by an emotionally disengaged mother. In the years since this book was first published, I have learned more about the variety of emotionally absent mothers and how emotional neglect and emotional abuse often come intertwined. In this expanded edition, I go further into the abuse aspects and what is wrong with Mother that causes her to act this way. The book now has three parts. Part one examines what children need from Mother. It looks at the elements of good mothering and the importance of this first attachment. In part two, we learn what happens when mothering goes wrong, what the impacts are from emotional neglect and abuse, and what leads mothers to fail their children in these ways. Part three tackles the subject of healing. After an overview of the healing process, chapters delve into psychotherapy, reparenting your inner child and making up for unmet needs, and negotiating your relationship with mother as an adult. There are a number of exercises in the book which you are free to complete or not. There are also pauses throughout the book that invite you to digest the material and reflect on your own situation. I encourage you to take a moment to consider these, listening for what comes to mind as you listen to them, even if you don't choose to formally answer each question. Since what you take away for yourself in terms of your own understanding and healing is an important benefit to listening to this book, I invite you to take your time. You have to be your own gatekeeper here, so if working with particular material is distressing, consider what kind of support you may need. Practice being a good mother to yourself by taking on only what you can handle at any given moment. You can always come back to the material at another time. Some listeners have found the first section on good mothering too evocative for them at the get-go and prefer to return to it later. So, although each chapter builds on what came before, the book can be worked with however it best suits you. My four goals in this book are to help you get a clearer picture of what kind of mothering you received, to help you see the connection between the mothering you experienced and the difficulties in your life. What have been thought of as personal defects can then be linked to mothering deficits, relieving self-blame. To provide suggestions for how these missing elements can be made up for now, whether in therapy, through close relationships, or by providing them for yourself. To help you decide how to proceed in your relationship with mother as an adult, giving you more tools and options than you may have started with. The good news is that the deficits of inadequate mothering can be made up for later. Maybe not completely, but more significantly than we usually dare to hope. We can heal the unloved child within and become empowered, loving adults. This is a journey worth taking. Part 1. What We Need from Mother. 1. Mothering. Mother as the tree of life. I will always remember an image in The Family of Man, a photo exhibit that traveled the world and was captured in book form. A tall, lanky black woman stood with two young children, their faces dark, caught in shadow. On the facing page, quoting Proverbs, were these words: "She is a tree of life to them." A tree of life. A tree providing shelter, home, protection. A tree you can climb on and eat from. A tree that seems big when you are many times smaller. A tree that is your tree. In world mystical traditions, the tree of life is the vertical axis around which life revolves. In a similar way, mother is the axis around which the family and the child's emotional life revolve. In the vast stretch of history before the Christian era, the tree of life was often depicted as a mother, and the great mother or goddess was often depicted as a tree. Thus, the tree is a natural symbol for mothering. With its fruits and flowers, with birds and animals in and around it, it provides both shelter and supply. Growing in many directions, but particularly with its arc of outward expansion, it is like a fountain of abundance. Part of the tree of life archetype is this sense of bounty and of giving. This archetype is captured in the children's book The Giving Tree by Shel Silverstein. Originally published in 1964, it is considered a classic parable of love and devotion. It is about a boy and a tree that loves him very much and gives him everything she has. She lets him swing on her branches, gives him shade to sit under, apples to eat, and branches to build a house. She even lets him cut down her trunk to make a boat. In the end, the tree only a stump and the boy an old man. She gives him a place to rest. As many have clearly noted, the relationship between the boy and the tree is much like that between a child and mother. The tree puts the boy's needs first. It gives and gives and gives. This is part of the role of a mother, which competes at times with a woman's own needs to develop herself as a person, apart from her mothering role and her relationship with others. Many women have lamented losing themselves in mothering and in being partners. Yet, if a woman isn't ready, at least for a period of her life, to attend to the needs of others, she really isn't ready for the task of mothering. There are many legitimate reasons a woman may be unable to fully take on the enormous task of mothering, yet unfortunately, women have often not been given, or not felt, a choice about this. Because of either unintentional pregnancy or social expectations, women may slide into motherhood without choosing it. Often, such women have not yet grown into full adults themselves. They are ill-equipped for what lies in front of them. It is not easy to give of yourself if you still have many unmet needs. Yet mothering requires constant giving. A good mother shares the warmth of her body when her child is cold, the milk from her breast when her child needs nourishment. She gives both the unborn child and the nursing child calcium from her bones. This is a very basic level of giving of oneself. No wonder mother is a symbol of sacrifice. Mommy is what we are made of. There are two important levels to the assertion that we are made of our mothers. The first is the obvious biological fact. We were made in her body, and we are made from her body. Then there is the psychological level, where mother is part of our personality, psyche, and structure. It's as if she is literally a layer of our being. You'll get a better understanding of this in the next several chapters. How we are put together, how we see ourselves, our sense of self-esteem, our unconscious beliefs about relationship, all of these are strongly imprinted by our mother. She is not the only influence, but she and our interactions with her provide the basic building materials for all of these things. Whether we feel that basic material as nourishing or toxic is largely determined by the quality of our interactions with our mother. It is not what mother does that is so critical, but rather her energetic presence and her love that are so important. Is she angry or spaced out while feeding her baby? When mother is really there in a loving way, then mommy's milk and mommy's heart don't feel separate. When she's not there, her milk is not as sustaining. The baby may feel not quite right taking it, perhaps because it is not so freely given, or because there's something unwanted in the interaction that comes along with the milk. As they would say in a children's rhyme, when this interaction is good, it feels very, very good, and when it is bad, it feels horrid. Of course, this view is more black and white than things usually are, but young children experience the world with great intensity. You can feel mother as an inner layer of support, a layer of love that is always with you, or you can feel as if there is something dead or toxic in you. This toxic substance is what you absorbed from your interactions with her, and perhaps from what was toxic inside her. Who can mother? I use the term mother all through the book, yet I don't necessarily limit this to the woman who gives birth to a particular child, although that relationship, even if it never goes beyond birth, because the mother dies or gives the baby away, marks a person's entire life. When I ask about your mother in this book, I'm asking about the person who functioned in this primary role, and the term good mother can refer to any adult who takes on a caring, nurturing, protective role in your life, fulfilling the functions described in the next chapter. This can include an adoptive mother, grandmother, or stepmother. Even the right father can fill these shoes. Others further outside the inner family circle can help meet some of the child's needs, even into adulthood. Teachers, aunts, mothers of friends, therapists, partners. We can even meet some of these needs for ourselves as we mature, understanding that the undermothered child is usually still alive in an adult, still needing what he needed then. Although not every woman adapts to the role of mothering, nature has done its best to give biological mothers every advantage. Research supports the idea that mothers, as a group, instinctively employ behaviors that infants prefer. Studies in Sweden found that even when a mother works outside the home and the father is the primary caretaker, babies still strongly prefer being with the mother. Nature also supports biological mothers through their hormones, especially oxytocin, which seem to put them in the mood for bonding and are directly correlated with bonding behaviors. Breastfeeding puts the infant at the perfect distance at which it can focus on the mother's eyes. Of course, the developing fetus has already been forming a relationship with the mother in the womb, responding to her heartbeat, her voice, her touch through the abdominal wall, and her energetic presence. Unfortunately, these biological advantages aren't enough for some women to overcome the lack of readiness they show for taking on the tasks of mothering. It is a good thing, then, that people other than biological mothers can mother. The good enough mother. Mothers don't need to be perfect, and can't be. The perfection, when there, is supplied through the eyes of the child, who, when the mother does a good enough job meeting her basic needs, feels total adoration. This is helpful, because when you're totally dependent on someone, you want to believe that person can do the job. To overlook the slips and lack of perfect attunement and accentuate the positive is both good psychological strategy and good evolutionary strategy, since the child's good feelings also help the mother bond to the child. The term good enough mother was coined by the famous pediatrician and psychoanalyst D.W. Winnicott to describe the mother who provides enough for a child to have a good start in life. Winnicott sees the primary job of the good enough mother as adapting to the baby. He describes how the good enough mother starts off with almost complete adaptation to her infant's needs and subsequently adapts less and less as the infant can tolerate more frustration. A mother who continued to satisfy all the infant's needs perfectly and immediately would rob the baby of the need to learn new behaviors, develop new skills, and be able to handle delay and frustration. Recent research reinforces this notion that the mother doesn't have to be 100% attuned and available to her child to offer good enough parenting. It suggests that what is needed is to be in sync, defined as in a harmonious state together with the mother attuned to the child 30% of the time. Is that really so much to ask? According to psychotherapist and author Diana Fauscia, what matters as much as, if not more than, the natural capacity to be in sync is the capacity to repair out of syncness so as to reestablish optimal connection. The good enough mother needs to repair the inevitable ruptures that occur in every relationship. She is not going to always behave just right, but she has to know how to make it right when she misses. Research suggests that she has help in this from her child. Babies come into the world with an urge toward and capacity for maintaining a strong bond with their mothers. They are also wired to make the most of the mother's reparative efforts. For a child to be able to rectify the inevitable disruptions in this relationship is empowering. Conversely, to not be able to get mother's attention, to not be able to reconnect after there has been a disconnection, can leave the baby feeling profoundly impotent and discouraged about relationships and about getting her needs met. When a mother is not attuned enough to respond to a child's needs, the child ends up adapting to the mother instead of the other way around. losing touch with his core experience, the child then develops what Winnicott calls a false self. Good mother messages. How mother responds to our basic needs tells us about our importance to her. Is she generous in giving to us, even joyful? Or does she meet our needs with a sense of burden and an attitude that says, "You're bothering me"? When she changes a diaper or dresses us, is her touch gentle and loving, or is it efficient and slightly brusque? Perhaps it seems mechanical. What do her eyes say? How about the expressions on her face? What do her actions and choices convey? All of these are a part of a mother's communication and shape our relationship to her. Together, they form the basis of the messages we receive. We start by looking at good mother messages, and then consider what those of us who are undermothered heard instead. Here are 10 basic good mother messages. I'm glad that you're here. I see you. You are special to me. I respect you. I love you. Your needs are important to me. You can turn to me for help. I am here for you. I'll make time for you. I'll keep you safe. You can rest in me. I delight in you. Let's look at these in more detail. I'm glad that you're here. I'm glad that you're here is an important first message for a child to hear. The message is communicated through behaviors that tell the child she is valued and wanted. Many believe that this fundamental sense of being wanted begins in utero. Certainly, there are many moments in children's lives in which they feel either wanted or not. I would suggest that this is not an all-or-nothing experience, but rather a matter of degree, and that isolated moments of feeling unwanted can be counterbalanced to a great extent by a larger stream of experiences where the child feels valued. The message, "I'm glad you're here," helps us be glad that we're here. It helps us feel comfortable taking up space and being in our bodies. I see you. A mother conveys "I see you" primarily through acute mirroring and attuned responsiveness. She knows, for instance, what we like and what we don't. She knows what our interests are and how we feel about things. Being seen is being known. You are special to me. The message "you are special to me," usually not said in words, tells us that we are prized. As is true with other messages, this needs to be paired with the sense of being seen for who we are so that we do not associate specialness with some superficial, external quality or image. I respect you. A mother communicates "I respect you" when she supports a child's uniqueness, doesn't try to control when there is no need to, accepts the child's preferences and decisions, and communicates that she values what she sees in the child. Children who feel respected and loved in a genuine way will have permission to discover and express their unique self, rather than mirror the parents or conform to some parental blueprint. I love you. I love you is often conveyed by these simple words, yet needs to be experienced as sincere and authentic in order to have meaning. Many children hear these words several times a day, others go a lifetime without them. It is important that they not be perceived as manipulative and not paired with requiring something of the child. Love is probably most effectively communicated by nonverbal means, including touch, tone of voice, eyes and facial expression, body language, and attentiveness. When the environment provides a secure sense of holding and containment, such as provided through boundaries and rules, this also feels like love. Your needs are important to me. You can turn to me for help. Your needs are important to me expresses a sense of priority. It's not just that mother is saying, "I'll take care of you because I have to," or "when I get to it," but because this is actually important. With this message, we get the sense that mother's attentiveness comes out of love and genuine caring. You can turn to me for help gives permission. It says you don't have to hide your needs or try to take care of them yourself. I am here for you. I'll make time for you. I am here for you is a way of saying you can count on me. I'm not going to disappear on you. Often this will relate to specific needs, but beyond that, it means I am here as a consistent presence in your life. This supports a sense of relaxation and trust. A related message would be I'll make time for you. It expresses availability, priority, and valuing. Unfortunately, too many children feel that their parents don't have time for them. I'll keep you safe. I'll keep you safe could also be expressed as I'll protect you. I won't let you be hurt or overwhelmed unnecessarily. A sense of safety is essential for a child to be able to relax and explore. Without safety, we may never feel ready to go out into the world. Without our caretaker's protection, our only protection is to stay small and build defensive structures into our personality. You can rest in me. You can rest in me is a way of saying several things. First, it implies a protected space. If you have to be on guard, you can't really rest. It also implies availability. Mother needs to be here to rest in, and acceptance. It is a way of saying, with me, you can be at home. We all want a place where we can be totally ourselves, where we don't have to perform, and where we feel soothed and comforted in the company of another. I delight in you. I delight in you provides an affirmation of the child's preciousness. It says to the child, you are a delight. You are a joy to be around. We see this when mother's eyes light up when she sees us, in her smile, her laugh. What happens when good mother messages are absent? When these good mother messages are absent, they leave specific holes or feelings of deficiency. Using the above list, it might look like this. I'm glad that you're here. When we don't feel welcomed or wanted, we may conclude, maybe it would be better if I weren't here. It can also lead to a great fear of abandonment. One woman who never felt wanted as a child was terrified every time she went to a restaurant or laundromat with her mother, that her mother would leave her and never come back. For a young child to not feel wanted is to have no solid ground. I see you. If mother doesn't see or know us, then her responses will not feel on target. She may try to guide, for instance, but starts in the wrong place. When we are consistently not seen, it can lead to feeling invisible and an uncertainty that we are real. The feeling of unreality can be subtle and generally unconscious, or it can be quite pervasive and disorienting. You are special to me. When we don't feel special to our parents, we don't feel cherished for who we are. We may even think, Mommy might like it better if I were someone else. I respect you. When we don't feel that our capacities, boundaries, and preferences are respected, we don't learn to respect these for ourselves. We may develop a sense of unworthiness and shame, or fail to actualize our true potential. This can also set us up to be too accommodating to other people rather than stand behind ourselves. I love you. With an absence of sufficient loving, we may conclude, I am unlovable as I am. Consequently, we may contort ourselves in the hope, if I conform to what others want, maybe they'll love me. Your needs are important to me. When we don't get a sense that mother wants to meet our needs, we can believe, my needs are shameful or a burden. I shouldn't have needs. I am here for you. Without a sense mother is here for us, we feel alone. It leads to the sense that I need to raise myself. I'll keep you safe. Without the sense of protection, we can feel overwhelmed by life and conclude that the world is dangerous. You can rest in me. When being with mother is not a safe place to be ourselves, we miss an important aspect of connection. Being with mother then becomes a time we need to stay alert or perform, and we never fully feel at home with her. I delight in you. Without a sense that mother enjoys us, we may conclude, I am a burden that nobody wants. I wish I could disappear. I shouldn't take up so much space. We shrink in ourselves and learn to hide our light. The messages you received. Go through each of the 10 good mother messages, and for each one, note your emotional response to it. Does this message feel familiar? Remember, these messages are communicated by behaviors more than through words. Is this a message you think you received? How does it feel in your body? You might compare each message in the first list with the corresponding one in the second list and see which seems more true for you, paying attention as best as you can to thoughts, emotions, and sensations in your body. As with any exercise in this book, this may bring up uncomfortable feelings, so you'll want to pace yourself. If you find yourself feeling overwhelmed, you might let it go for now and come back to it when you're ready, or do the exercise when you have a supportive person present. What does it mean to be undermothered? When you don't get enough good mothering in terms of these good mother messages, the functions described in Chapter 2, the secure attachment of Chapter 3, or the nurturing touch and love and other building blocks in Chapter 4, you are undermothered. Yes, you received enough mothering to survive, but not enough for the kind of foundation that supports healthy self-confidence, initiative, resilience, trust, healthy entitlement, self-esteem, and the many other qualities we need to thrive in this challenging world. The more clearly you can see the ways you are insufficiently mothered, the more proactively you can make up for them. Let's learn more about what was missing. 2. The many faces of the good mother. The perceptual world, and specifically the visual world, of the infant contains many experiences of the same few objects. Yet each experience is quite distinct and different, so much so that from the infant's point of view, they seem to be different objects. In a somewhat similar way, we can take the image of the good mother and separate it into different experiences, which I call the many faces of the good mother. Each face represents a role that she fulfills, or a psychological function important for the child's development. After reading this chapter, you may wonder how one person can fulfill so many important and seemingly endless tasks. Of course, no one can perfectly, which makes our picture of the good mother an ideal or model. By reflecting on how well your mother fulfilled each of these psychological functions, you will understand more about her fingerprint on your psyche and bring more insight into your feelings, beliefs, and behaviors. You'll understand why some parts of you need more shoring up than others. You'll also notice that many of these roles overlap, and it may seem arbitrary at moments to try to separate them. They work together to do their magic and create the larger-than-life archetype of the good mother. In dissecting the good mother this way, we may take away a little of her mystery, but perhaps the cost is worth it if it helps us see our needs more clearly and get serious about meeting them. Please keep in mind that although I am talking about these as functions of the mother, they can be fulfilled by any caregiver and are not strictly limited to biological mothers. Fathers, grandparents, nannies, daycare workers, extended family members, and even mother figures found later in life can provide some of these important nutrients. The 10 faces are as follows. Mother as source. Mother as place of attachment. Mother as first responder. Mother as modulator. Mother as nurturer. Mother as mirror. Mother as cheerleader. Mother as mentor. mother as protector, mother as home base, mother as source. Mother is what we come from and what we are made of. In mythology and religion, this source is often depicted as some kind of mother goddess, often an ocean goddess. Just as life is thought to have evolved from the ocean, human life evolves from the mother, and more specifically, the womb. Thus, at both the mythological level and the more mundane, the source of life is mother. When the child has a positive experience of mother, he gets the sense, I am of mommy, I came from her, I'm part of her, I'm like her. This becomes a building block of identity. Unfortunately, not everyone has an experience of mother as source in a positive way. Some adults, through an experience of age regression and hypnosis or any kind of depth work, recover memories of the womb as a toxic environment they are trapped in. They have a strong sense of being of, but it's an icky of, from which they would rather be separate. This also happens with engulfing mothers who are not experienced in a positive way. Then there is the experience of children put up for adoption whose source has, at least on a subjective level, rejected them. They are in the complex situation of being both of this first mother since she gave birth to them and also not of her because they do not continue to belong to her. Sometimes it's challenging for them to develop a firm sense of belonging to their adopted mother. Having a sense of belonging somewhere is essential, and the sense of mother as source is only one part of it. As we'll see, it also comes into play when we experience mother as the place of attachment. Although some of this may be beyond mother's control, there are things mother can do to be experienced as source in a positive way. She can create a welcoming environment from the first moments of life. She can be a positive energy that her children want to be around and are nourished by. She can draw similarities between herself and her child, while careful to give the child plenty of room to also be different. And she can be a positive role model that her children, throughout their lives, will be proud of. Your mother as source. When you think of your mother's womb, does it feel like an inviting place? If you can't imagine this, ask how it would feel to be enveloped in your mother's energy. Is that something you would like? Did you want to be like your mother, or did you want to be as different as possible, or anything in between? If someone said, you are so like your mother, how would you feel? Can you imagine feeling pride about being your mother's child? Do you identify yourself in relation to your mother? Mother as place of attachment. Mother is our first connection to the world. Here we focus not on mother as the ocean we come from, but as the more immediate place where we are attached, like the underside of a boat that a barnacle fastens to. Mother is the belly of the ship that a securely attached child clings to. When you watch securely attached toddlers and young children with their mothers, they are in constant physical contact, climbing over, pulling on, sucking, and hugging the mother's body. Even an older child will take mother's hand when scared. As we'll learn below, attachment is not created just through body contact, but also through the mother's attunement and responsiveness to needs. Attachment is so important that the whole next chapter is devoted to it. Attachment for the young child brings the feeling, I belong to you, and because I belong to you, I have a place. Without this, we are untethered, adrift, well into our adult years. One woman felt like a piece of driftwood out at sea. Another was so unbonded to her mother that she felt as if she must have been found under a cabbage leaf, or may as well have been. This can result in a profound sense of aloneness, alienation, and not belonging. With secure attachment, a child feels securely held, safe. This function overlaps with mother as first responder because it is largely through this function of being responsive to needs that attachment is formed. Your mother as place of attachment. On a scale of 1 through 10, with 10 being extremely connected, how connected would you say you feel to your mother? How has this changed throughout your life? What are your early memories around physical contact with your mother? Was she your jungle gym, or was there more a sense of keep out? As a child, did you clearly feel part of your family? Did you feel bonded or adrift? Have you had feelings of being an orphan or motherless child? Mother as first responder. A very important role that secures mother in her role as place of attachment is what I call mother as first responder. The first responders in our modern world are firefighters and police officers, the folks you call when there is an emergency. Imagine your home is on fire and no one comes. How would that affect you in terms of believing help will be there when you need it? As many authors have convincingly shown, every need feels urgent to a baby and thus is an emergency. As babies, we had no way of meeting our basic needs and were entirely dependent on others to be responsive to our calls for help. When our needs are consistently met, we feel secure and trust that help will be there. Without this, we learn that care is not available, the world doesn't feel friendly or supportive, and we feel more insecure and mistrustful. We don't know that we will have what we need, which jeopardizes our basic sense of trust. The good mother messages related to this are, I'll take care of you. Your needs are important to me. I am here for you. You can rest in me. Of course, to do this, a mother needs to be tuned in to her child in an accurate way. It doesn't help if the first responder goes to the wrong address, offers shelter when what's needed is food, or insists on giving you what you don't want. In psychological parlance, we call this accuracy attunement. Mother as first responder will be helpful to the extent she is attuned to her child's needs. This is especially true for the early years before language. This attunement and responsiveness to needs provides what is called a holding environment. With it, we feel held. This function is also what leads to self-regulation, described next in Mother as Modulator. Your mother as first responder. It may be hard to remember how your mother responded to you as an infant and small child, but often a telltale clue is how you feel about your needs now. Are you respectful and attentive to your needs, or so ashamed of needing that you try to hide them? Or perhaps you are demanding. How you respond to your own needs most often parallels how your mother responded to your needs. Unless there have been a number of significant imprinting experiences that gave you a different reference point. What information do you have about how your mother responded to your needs? What stories have you heard? What do photographs show? Beyond your early childhood, what do you know about how your mother tended to respond to other people's needs? Was she Johnny on the spot? Resentful? Not so competent? Gracious? Did people need to ask multiple times? Did she meet what she assumed to be others' needs, rather than finding out what the real needs were? Mother as Modulator. Mother as Modulator is very much interrelated with Mother as First Responder, but by tilting the picture just a little bit and giving it a different name, we see it in a different way. When Mother is there as First Responder, the fire doesn't rage out of control. To give but one example, the baby's hunger is met, and he can return to a state of homeostasis and rest. Imagine the intolerable discomfort when this is not true. To modulate something is to make sure it's not too strong and not too weak, but falls within a more optimal range. The mother helps manage her child's physiological states, such as being hungry or cold, by meeting those specific needs. Most often, when therapists are talking about regulation, they are referring to our emotions. Without mother as an effective modulator, we don't learn to effectively manage our emotions. Either we cut off feelings, or our emotional states tend to spiral out of control. Anger turns into rage, crying into hysteria. We can't contain our excitement, frustration, sexual impulses, or anything else. Learning to modulate our internal states is called self-regulation or self-modulation. It is something the nervous system, for the most part, controls, but it is learned initially by the mother standing in for the developing nervous system and by meeting the child's needs before he gets totally overwhelmed. Mother as modulator serves as a cushion to the child's fragile nervous system while it is developing. There are a number of ways a mother can accomplish this. She can soothe the distressed child, whether through touch, words, or simply her caring presence. Help the child identify needs and emotions. Help turn the child's attention away from the distress, thus modulating it, and provide reassurance. One woman who has suffered lifelong anxiety told me that she never once heard her mother say, "It will be all right." Her mother never calmed her or helped her feel better. When mother is modulator, she helps us transition from negative emotional experiences to positive ones. One way she does this is by first empathizing with what is going on and then leading us to more comfortable territory. She shows us how to let go of one emotion and move on to another, and in her own cheerfulness gives us something brighter to join with. We see this in the mother who meets her child's tears with a sad face and soon has her child laughing. On a yet more subtle level, mother modulates a child's distress through a process more recently called limbic resonance or limbic regulation. In limbic regulation, one person's emotional brain entrains another's, whose emotional brain shifts to match the first person's. All mammals have this capacity, and it is thought to be a major mechanism through which an infant or young child's inner state is directly modulated by mother. Just by gazing into the child's eyes, the mother communicates brain to brain with her child, bringing the child's limbic system into coherence with hers. This is helpful when mother is in a positive, regulated state, but not when she is fussy and upset herself. An inability to regulate physiological arousal is common in those whose childhoods match up with the description of complex trauma, as found with emotionally neglectful and abusive parents. When people lacking modulation are triggered by something, they can get so upset that they can't think clearly or stay fully present. It's as if there isn't a regulator on their system, so they can't keep their physical and emotional responses within a manageable or optimal range. Although we can learn self-regulation later in life, it saves us a lot of grief if mother helps us master this critical.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.